For Shakespeare, Italy was a land of beauty and artistic invention. But it was also a melting pot of powerful city-states and political ideas competing to be heard. Venice was proud of its pioneering democracy, a republic in a world of kings and queens. Ancient beliefs wobbled in the face of new ideas about trade, science, and politics. Even classical Rome stood as a reminder of how an absolute ruler could be brought down by the people. Such ideas were the stuff of nightmares for an aging Queen Elizabeth, whose iron grip on England was weakening. And yet this country's air of timelessness, its romance, made it the perfect place to tell dangerous stories and survive to write another day. Shakespeare wanted to write about politics and ideas that were likely to get him into trouble with the Elizabethan authorities. But if he said things in Italy, wrapped up in local stories and legends, it looked like it was nothing to do with England. In other words, it was Italy that saved Shakespeare from the Tower of London. It's 7 a.m. and Venice is waking up.
Dai ragazzi, forza.
Time to get the children to school.
Pierangelo!
Pierangelo is 11 years old. He's got an easy morning ahead. His favorite lesson, carpentry.
Let me talk to you.
My daughter Delia is 16. She's heading for a heavy morning. Oh, Shakespeare.
Grazie mille.
Ciao, baby.
Ciao, papà. Ma cosa corri, cioè, che sta tutto il militare, cosa sei?
Ok, ragazzi, buongiorno. Oggi trattiamo un autore del teatro elisabettiano. Quale è William Shakespeare?
This is a mandatory class in the English language syllabus for third year high school students.
Shakespeare ha ambientato numerose delle sue opere in Italia e sapreste farmi qualche esempio? In quali città ha ambientato alcune opere?
A Venezia.
A Venezia, sicuramente. Per esempio, quali opere?
Beh, Otello, il Mancante di Venezia.
Perché secondo voi sceglieva proprio l'Italia?
Perché probabilmente l'Italia comunque era un posto romantico e diverso, diciamo, dall'Inghilterra.
Luogo romantico, comunque luogo poco conosciuto, e quindi l'Italia era considerato un luogo lontano, misterioso, dove tutto sommato tutto poteva accadere.
By Shakespeare's time, the city was a spectacle of fine buildings in stone and marble. English visitors must have been amazed, especially when you think that most of London was still made out of wood. In many ways, 16th century Venice was what England dreamt of becoming. We were the most modern city in Europe. While most of the nation were still feudal, stuck in the Dark Ages, we were liberated into the modern world of money and trade. Of course, not having much land had something to do with it. In England, large land ownership was in the hands of the few. Just having water, we had to find something else to define power. And that was commerce. This was the place to make your fortune. The Corel Museum sits at the heart of Venice. It looks after some of our best treasures. It's here that you find the key to the origins of the Merchant of Venice. As with so many of the plays that Shakespeare set in Italy, there is an Italian source. He found much of the narrative in an Italian novella of the time, Il Pecorone, by Giovanni Fiorentino. This is an original from 1554. The book tells the same story of a merchant who asks a Jewish moneylender for a loan. If he defaults, he has to deliver a pound of Christian flesh. Of course, the Jewish moneylender in the play is Shylock, who's gone down in history as one of theater's worst villains. But a friend of mine, who knows the play intimately, believes we've got Shylock all wrong.
Thanks for coming.
Wow.
Let me show you the city. Let's go.
Of course. Thank you.
You may recognize Kieran Hines from his role as Caesar in the HBO series, Rome. He's a fabulous Shakespearean actor, and he's played the Merchant of Venice.
And here we are. This is one of the bridges that takes you to the Jewish quarter of Venice.
In the play, Shylock's home would have been here. In Shakespeare's time, the Jews who lived in Venice were at the heart of the city's business and trade.
You see the houses, because there was not so much space, then they were building one floor on top of the other one.
All right.
Jews traded and did business free of restrictions, making Venice into Europe's richest city. By comparison, commerce in London was stuck in the Dark Ages.
Well, Shylock is one of the great, great characters that Shakespeare wrote. I mean, he's the sort of the ultimate outsider, you know, the Jewish man in the center of a huge Christian community. And the crux of the matter is between the Christian businessman and the Jewish businessman, and two different rules.
Yeah, because it was sin in the Bible for Christians to lend and borrow money.
Oh, right, for profit. Yeah. Yes, they could lend it, but not to make profit. Whereas in the Jewish thing, the idea was that when you have money of collateral, you lend it, you make a little from it. You don't rob people, you don't steal from them, you make a little from it, and that builds up your business. So it was a sense of business. But because they did that their way, the Shylock in The Merchant, we find out he's been insulted, abused, spat on by the Christian community. I'll read you a little bit that he says about Antonio, the Christian merchant. He hath disgraced me and hindered me half a million, laughed at my losses, mocked at my gains, scorned my nation, thwarted my bargains, cooled my friends, heated mine enemies, and what's his reason? I am a Jew. Hath not a Jew eyes? Hath not a Jew hands, organs, dimensions, senses, affections, passions, fed with the same food, hurt with the same weapons, subject to the same diseases, healed by the same means? warmed and cooled by the same winter and summer as a Christian is? If you prick us, do we not bleed? If you tickle us, do we not laugh? If you poison us, do we not die? And if you wrong us, shall we not revenge?
Shylock's speech is literature's greatest rallying cry against prejudice and injustice. The climax of the play is a trial at the Doge's palace, home of the Venetian government. The trial will decide Shylock's fate. But it will also reveal how Venice is very different to Elizabethan England.
Wow.
Yeah, this is the hall of the major council where the nobles of Venice were meeting. And there are all the successes of Venice, the glories of Venice.
This is extraordinary.
Yeah. And up there, all the doges of Venice. It was here that they were electing the doges because Venice was a democracy. And so the power was not passing from a father to a son, but the doges were elected, and they were elected here.
As opposed to a monarchy in England, which was handed down from the royals.
Yeah, so you get the power only with the election.
So it was all about justice. This is the room where things are decided. Because I was just thinking, the scene, the big trial scene in The Merchant of Venice,
yeah,
where Shylock comes in. It's in the fourth act, and there's this huge trial scene. And the doge says to him, I hope you will be gentle with this justice. And Shylock is very direct about keeping to the contract that he made. And he finishes with this extraordinary statement. He says, if you deny me, fie upon your law. There is no force in the decrees of Venice. So he throws it back. He says, you may think this is cruel, but he said, this is a deal, a contract. And if you don't honor this contract, then everything you stand for, the justice, the law, holds no weight or water.
The Merchant of Venice is the first of Shakespeare's Italian plays to put Elizabethan society on trial. Compared to London, Venice is modern and exciting. Next, Shakespeare would turn his critical gaze to the very heights of power, the Queen herself. Rome, heart of the greatest empire the world has ever seen. Home to Julius Caesar, Rome's greatest military leader. And on the 15th of March, 44 BC, the site of history's most infamous assassination.
A play that showed a leader being brutally murdered was a sensitive subject. Certainly not Queen Elizabeth's favorite topic. In the last two decades of her reign, Elizabeth was the object of several assassination plots.
She survived them all, though some were near misses. Elizabeth had been in absolute control for too long. Tyranny and uncertainty about the future
made both Elizabeth's London and the Rome of Julius Caesar volatile places.
Nice to see you.
Ciao,
thank you so much. And I tell you one thing, I love your hair. I always remember it's something like an image that is part of yourself, I think.
Yeah, I like hats, yeah. But Elizabethans wore hats.
So we go directly to the point.
There we go.
Actor-director Mark Rylance is a passionate believer in Shakespeare's genius to camouflage dangerous ideas.
It's quite curious because when I look at the Romans play of Shakespeare, like Julius Caesar, Antony and Cleopatra, Coriolanus, Titus Andronicus, in a certain way.
I like the way you say that, Titus Andronicus.
I mean, maybe because from the Latin I had to learn, so
very
I go
good,
with that.
Very good.
It seems like that Shakespeare is using the ancient Rome as a mirror of the London of that period.
Yeah. Yeah, that in any kind of repressive regime, and this is a repressive regime, you entered London, if you entered through London Bridge, you know, with heads on spikes above the bridge of the traitors, rotting heads, it was clear that you don't play around in this city, that if she doesn't like something, Elizabeth has your head off. And the one thing at the time of the writing of Julius Caesar that she had forbidden anyone to even mention was succession. Though she was about to die, everyone knew she was about to die, and everyone feared civil war, she would not let anyone talk about it. And they were talking about it by writing plays about the kings who and queens who preceded her, Richard II, Henry IV, she comes to the play of Richard II and remarks, or she remarks to someone after seeing it, can't you see it's me, that what the play is about me. Mm-hmm. And the bringing down of a queen or a king. Just before Julius Caesar is written, there's a book written about Henry IV, and she has these books banned and burnt because she says they are, behind the disguise of history, they are talking about succession. And it's just after that Shakespeare turns to Julius Caesar and goes into ancient foreign Italian history to deal with the very question of what do you do with a tyrant, or perhaps a wonderful tyrant, but a tyrant whose time is finished.
The tyrannical behavior of Caesar becomes too much for the people of Rome, and he's brutally murdered. Shakespeare chooses the Campidoglio for the site of the assassination.
Shakespeare makes the murder gruesome and gory. Caesar has no chance as Brutus and the others stab him 23 times. Then the assassins cover themselves in his blood.
As usual, Shakespeare had a first-rate Italian source, a biography of Julius Caesar, written in the late 1st century AD.
Buongiorno.
Buongiorno, benvenuto alla Biblioteca Alessandrina.
Grazie infinite.
Andiamo nel magazzino dove è custodito il fondo antico della biblioteca.
La seguo.
Lei mi aspetta fuori?
Sto qua.
Grazie. Questo è uno degli esemplari delle vite degli uomini illustri di Plutarco del XVI secolo.
Sansovino di Venezia.
Sì, Venezia. Venezia è stato uno dei più grandi centri tipografici del Rinascimento e si tratta di due volumi insieme. Ogni vita è preceduta da una sorta di frontespizio dove è presente quello che oggi potremmo chiamare un abstract, mm-hmm, che agevola la lettura, come naturalmente anche le note al testo.
Come dei capitoletti,
sì,
per capire dove...
Che in qualche modo orientano il lettore. Si tratta di vite a confronto, vite parallele, di personaggi significativi della storia greca e della storia latina. Ricordiamo che siamo in pieno periodo rinascimentale, l'uomo è tornato ad essere il centro dell'universo, Cesare, uomo raffinato, oltre che grande generale, scrittore essenziale, fantastico, e quindi come fonte di ispirazione della tragedia shakespeariana.
E quindi come può averle lette, diciamo, Shakespeare?
Ma posso semplicemente avanzare delle ipotesi. Che Shakespeare possa aver avuto accesso, possa aver letto una traduzione inglese delle Vite degli Uomini Illustri, oppure può averla letta in italiano, posto che l'italiano allora aveva una diffusione notevole in quanto lingua della cultura, oppure forse l'ipotesi più verosimile è che l'abbia letta direttamente in latino.
The English Queen died of natural causes, as it happens, and was succeeded by her cousin James. It was a period of waiting to see what would happen next. At the beginning of the 1600s, the world was becoming a much more dangerous place. In 1605, London is shocked by the boldest attempt in history to wipe out an entire government, the Gunpowder Plot. A fear of civil war defined the beginning of the new century. Shakespeare was determined to confront the urgent question of how government could be strong and fair at the same time. On the surface, Antony and Cleopatra is a great love story, full of passion, sexual magnetism, and longing. A love affair of two leaders, a Roman general and the Queen of Egypt. But it's really a manifesto for effective leadership, for a new brutal and dangerous age. In England, the response to the Gunpowder Plot was an aggressive clampdown. King James' retaliation was merciless. His men relentlessly rounded up the suspects. No one with any Catholic sympathies was safe. In Antony and Cleopatra, Shakespeare confronts this paradox of the age. Only strong leadership prevents chaos. And yet, one man with too much power inevitably falls prey to his flaws. Rome has entrusted its security to its military leader, Mark Antony. But then, he goes and falls in love. This statue is reputed to be Cleopatra, but it's also said to be the goddess Venus. Shakespeare describes Cleopatra as though he had seen this very statue, saying Cleopatra outshone Venus for her beauty. Age cannot wither her, nor custom stale her infinite variety. Other women cloy the appetites they feed, but she makes hungry where most she satisfies. Cleopatra's beauty drives Antony mad, and the citizens of Rome suffer for it. Because a leader acts like an ordinary man, it's a disaster for everyone. In the new age of uncertainty, a leader needed to behave differently. If we are looking for the political message at the heart of the play, forget Antony and Cleopatra. Shakespeare is more interested in Octavius. He outmaneuvers everyone and plays according to a new book of rules. Florence, birthplace of the Renaissance. The city was home to the most influential names of the Renaissance. Leonardo da Vinci, Michelangelo, we remember. But we often forget another genius of the age. Meet Niccolò Machiavelli, citizen of Florence, diplomat, statesman, philosopher, historian, musician, poet, and playwright. But Machiavelli was a man who knew too well the fragile nature of civilization. It would shape everything he went on to do. Machiavelli was just 18 years old when he saw for himself how order, beauty, the whole civilization could go up in flames. In 1497, books, paintings, even musical instruments were burned in the name of God on the infamous bonfire of the vanities. It was a religious fundamentalism that led to the terrible destruction of so much Florentine art and beauty. Machiavelli's gift to the Renaissance will be a book to show how government must operate to stop such vandalism. It's one of the most treasured possessions in the National Library of Florence. Machiavelli wanted a world in which men would take control to ensure that civilization flourished. His masterpiece was called De Principatibus. We know it today as The Prince. This one slim volume would make Machiavelli the father of modern politics. An edition in Italian was only newly available in London when Shakespeare was a young man, even though it had been a popular seller in Italy for years. Eccolo.
Con attenzione.
Sicuramente, che meraviglia, grazie. Look, this is an edition from 1532. The Prince is a set of astonishing observations on leadership, how to be a good leader and how to judge a leader. Look at this. A prince cannot observe all those things for which men are esteemed, being often forced in order to maintain the state, to act contrary to faith, friendship, humanity and religion. And even this one. The first opinion of a ruler's intelligence is to judge the quality of the men he has around him. It was dangerous stuff to explore in an age of kings and queens, popes and religious dogmatism. When he wrote The Prince, Machiavelli was exiled from Florence and living in the village of Sant'Andrea in Percussina. Even today, there is an atmosphere of a hideaway, more than a home, and few visitors make the trip. I'm going to meet Lucia Migliorini, the caretaker.
Ciao!
Oh, prego, eccomi qua. Buongiorno, benvenuto!
Grazie!
Accomodati. Questa è la casa, vedi, dove lui ha vissuto ed era una proprietà di 60 ettari, di cui 26 ettari a vigneto e includeva anche la casa e l'osteria albergaccio che si trova qui di fronte.
È abbastanza intimo come luogo.
Sì, sì. L'architettura è una casa di fine 400.
Volte a crociera.
Con le volte. E poi c'è il suo mobilio del 500. Infatti vedi la cassapanca con il suo stemma che ha una croce e i chiodi. Vieni, questo è lo studio dove scriveva le sue lettere, qui descriveva la sua vita rurale, andava da Italialegna con un libro di Dante e di Petrarca sotto braccio e poi la sera tornava a casa, nella sua casa si spogliava di questi abiti semplici della giornata e si sedeva, si metteva gli abiti dello scrittore. E qui annuncia in una sua lettera, ha scritto De Principatibus, che è un libretto, dice lui, che corrisponde al Principe, la opera sua più famosa. Vieni, Francesco. Ti faccio vedere le cantine, le stesse celle da vino, come lui scrive nelle lettere, che si trovano proprio sotto la sua casa.
Fantastico!
Queste sono le botti di rovere e c'è una leggenda che dice che questo era un passaggio segreto che il Machiavelli faceva quando era in esilio per andare dall'altra parte.
E di là andava bene, un fumo di vino meraviglioso.
Of course, today Machiavelli has a slightly tarnished image, as the political philosopher who said lying to the people could sometimes be justified. But Shakespeare knew the prince was much more than that. It was an early sign of a new age beginning to free itself of superstition and religion.
Fantastic. Allora Machiavelli.
Al Machiavelli.
We Italians are passionate people, but our tendency to lose control has a dark, explosive side too. If you cannot reinvent human nature, at least reshape it. So we invented rules for fighting, an entire etiquette of the sword. Vincenzo Saviolo made fighting into an art form, so ugly feuds were transformed into honorable quarrels. Saviolo settled in London in 1590. He opened a fancy school and wrote the world's best book on fighting in English. It's possible Saviolo even knew Shakespeare, and he might have trained his fellow actors how to fight on stage.
Wow. Yeah. Posso intromettervi senza rischiare come lui? Francesco.
Giovanni.
Che duello era questo?
Epoca rinascimentale, quindi è Rinascimento, dove si praticava spada e cappa. La grande caratteristica è che il dito indice andava sopra l'elsa e quindi si gestiva la punta. La spada si adoperava sempre accompagnata ad una seconda arma, in questo caso è la cappa.
Ah, ecco.
Nasce come mantello.
Sì. Andava così.
Per coprirsi dalle intemperie e dal clima.
E poi dopo diventava
in caso di necessità veniva imbracciato sul braccio sinistro e si utilizzava
come facevano i romani la rete, tipo.
Esatto.
Qualcosa
esatto.
Del
la funzione
genere.
È sempre quella.
Allora, questa è la spada.
E daga.
Questa è la daga.
Esattamente.
Come le armi di saviolo, no?
Esattamente.
Ok.
Le armi di saviolo. Allora, facciamo una cosa. Facciamo provare lei, le mettiamo un bel giubbotto protettivo, lo prova.
Aia. Ok. Caspita. Saviolo defined the whole style of fighting, from the way you position your body.
Busto okay. Bello diritto.
To every move of rapier and dagger.
Adesso facciamo la stoccata.
La stoccata. The different positions of the feet and body too.
Oh.
Shakespeare uses Saviolo's precise terms again and again. Stoccata è la mossa in Romeo e Giulietta di Shakespeare, no?
Esattamente.
Insieme anche a quell'altra, com'è la?
Imbroccata.
Imbroccata, ecco.
Imbroccata. Adesso fai questo movimento. Op.
Oh.
Spingi con tutta la tua forza. Oppa, eccolo lì. Questa okay. È l'imbroccata. Allora, punta reversa. La daga mettila sopra la spada. Così.
Allora, questa devi difendere.
Eh sì, eh. Hai capito. E braccio disteso, braccio disteso, braccio disteso, spingi. Eccolo. Metti la daga sopra. Eccolo lì.
Wow,
ah, questa
bello.
È la punta reversa.
Saviolo fights like a man playing chess, forcing his opponent into a predictable mode of attack. In my case, of course, it's immediate defeat.
Ma vedo.
Like Machiavelli, Saviolo is a modern thinker, anticipating a more sophisticated world. It would not be a world without conflict, but at least one with new rules. Shakespeare keeps looking beyond medieval beliefs still in place in England. In his last great play, he would take things even further. He would question the very forces of nature. Naples, to this day, one of the most superstitious places in Italy. It is just off the coast here that Shakespeare locates his terrible tempest, conjured up by sorcery.
Here in Naples, magic and alchemy flourished. In Shakespeare's time, Naples was home to the Accademia dei Segreti, the mysterious Academy of Secrets. It was run by Giambattista della Porta, a model for Shakespeare's last great character, the magician Prospero.
Prospero is a man obsessed with regaining control of the world by harnessing its energies. In 16th century Naples, the real della Porta worked obsessively to discover the secret of nature. From practicing magic and the occult to the beginnings of serious scientific inquiry. Della Porta was one of a new breed. The alchemist, curious, learned, and a little crazy. In the National Library of Naples, I'm meeting Massimo Marra, an expert in esoteric arts.
Massimo.
Ciao Francesco.
Grazie infinite.
Benvenuto.
Ti seguo.
Andiamo.
Questa è un'edizione del 1589 del Magiae Naturalis di Giovan Battista della Porta. Ecco, qui c'è questo prezioso frontespizio. Ci sono innumerevoli edizioni di questo libro che diventa in effetti il libro di magia probabilmente più diffuso in Europa e per questo poi Giovan Battista della Porta diventa un po' l'archetipo dell'immagine rinascimentale del mago. Si tratta veramente di un'idea di mago che investiga la natura nella sua totalità, dalla cosmesi alla medicina, fino ad arrivare alla metallurgia, addirittura all'alchimia, cioè alla trasmutazione dei metalli vili in oro.
È tipo questo De Metallorum Trasmutazione. Chissà se ci riuscivano veramente.
Ci sono diverse interpretazioni, c'è senz'altro un'interpretazione di tipo simbolico, dal punto di vista spirituale. L'oro era proprio rappresentativo di una condizione spirituale di completezza, del mago, diciamo.
C'è un'altra qualche... De Mulierum Cosmetici.
Sono i cosmeti che sono estremamente gettonate, perché sono il primo momento in cui nell'industria dell'editoria si fa molto chiara la potenzialità del mercato femminile.
Io, parlando di maghi, io penso a degli eretici.
In effetti, in genere, il mago che viene perseguitato, l'alchimista che viene perseguitato, l'astrologo che, cade in disgrazia, è quasi sempre legato, diciamo, a un'idea che lo rende inviso al potere.
It was a dangerous time for Shakespeare to be writing about alchemy and magic. King James was pursuing a ferocious campaign against witchcraft. He believed it was an evil that had to be eradicated. But alchemists were the ancestors of modern scientists. In the 17th century, they were the only people asking serious questions about the nature of the universe, about life and death. This is the Cimitero of the Fontanelle, a real city for the dead. The origin of this place goes back to the 16th century, when it was used to collect the bodies of the victims of many disasters the city went through. Earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, and a great plague. By 1656, there were said to be as many as 300,000 corpses here. Neapolitans have always believed in magic, and they are the most superstitious people in Italy. For hundreds of years, they've been coming here looking for ways to make contact with the dead. This was the strange thing about alchemy. Some of it was mad, and some of it was way ahead of its time. I think Shakespeare knew that. Maybe he also had thoughts of his own mortality and was full of questions. At Naples Hospital of the Incurables, there is an ancient pharmacy where the ghosts of alchemy seem present even now. I'm here to meet Professor Gennaro Rispoli, a specialist at the hospital.
Ciao Francesco.
Gennaro, grazie infinite.
Sei venuto per entrare in farmacia?
Per entrare nella cava di Aladino.
Questo è un posto d'arte del Rococò di Napoli, ma anche un luogo di scienze e di magia. Guarda questa chiave.
La chiave di un mondo.
Questa apre una porta, tante cose segrete, scoperte. Prego, entra. Senti il profumo. È tutto... il legno, la radica di noce, che profuma da 300 anni. La farmacia è ancora più antica perché le sue origini sono del 500. Ci sono 400 vasi che contengono i farmaci che sono la promessa di guarigione per gli ammalati incurabili, quelli affetti da sifilide nel 500.
E questi cosa sono?
Sono dei piccoli contenitori di vetro che contengono ancora, vedi, il vetriolo, antimonio. Vedi la polvere di mummia, per esempio.
Qual è?
Eccola. O anche, per esempio, il Cremon Tartaro, vedi l'Assenzio. Vedi, questi sono denti di squali, per esempio. Sono uno dei rimandi alla tradizione alchemica ed esoterica presente nel Cinquecento e qui molto forte a Napoli. Molti di questi farmaci avevano dei principi attivi validi dal punto di vista scientifico. È la scienza che è nata dalle ceneri dell'alchimia e della magia.
Shakespeare's magician Prospero is much more of an alchemist than a sorcerer. He uses his knowledge to restore order to the world. Even the word tempest carried a double meaning in Shakespeare's day. Both the word for a storm and the alchemical term for boiling base metal to make it pure. I'm meeting my old friend, Giulio Maresca.
Comandante Giulio!
Mamma mia, quanto tempo! Sì. Sei una bellezza! Grande!
E questo è
questo è il nostro yacht.
E qui salve il mondo.
Pronti?
Vado?
Aspetta. Vieni.
A few years ago, Giulio sailed with me from Venice to Istanbul. So I know I'm in safe hands.
Vado? E vai che si parte di nuovo, e via!
In the play, Prospero is trapped on an island between Naples and Tunisia. The same geographical location as the island where Giulio grew up, the island of Stromboli.
Eccoci.
Stromboli is no ordinary island. It is a giant volcano rising out of the sea.
Quest'isola è strana, è energia allo stato puro, e la cosa la avverti, insomma.
In balia del vulcano.
Completamente. Sei tu, il vulcano, il mare, e si fa sentire, eh. Vibrano le finestre, senti il tremolio, poi alzi la testa e vedi il pennacchio di fuoco. Non lo so, è come un parente, è come un vecchio genitore che ogni tanto borbotta e ti dice, attento, sai?
Shakespeare only tells us it is a rocky and barren island, not that it is a volcano. But as Prospero unleashes the tempest, it is as though he has unlocked volcanic forces from beneath the seabed.
Prospero is no mad magician. Like the alchemists of Naples, he wants to discover natural magic. When he's asked to explain what he's been doing, this is what he answers. Spirits, which by mine art, have from their confines called to enact my present fancies.
Science and reason have triumphed over confusion. The tempest is Shakespeare's premonition of an age of enlightenment and beyond. Even now we struggle to harness the forces of nature to our own ends. Shakespeare's Italian journey ends here. He has explored the power of money, the power of politics, and ultimately the power of science, the defining interests of the modern age. And he hasn't spent a single day in jail. The Tempest was Shakespeare's farewell to the world. But it is an optimistic gesture. In an age of tyrants, he has the last laugh. As we say in Italy, a casa sua, ognuno è re. Everybody's king in his own home. Shakespeare's genius was to make Italy his home whenever he needed it.